All right, fresh start. Welcome. I just want to say welcome to all our new visitors today. Go ahead and text welcome to 559-245-6200. That way we can just get in touch with you, send you a welcome text. So, our men's retreat is coming up next weekend. If you haven't signed up, go ahead and do that. The cost is $200. Today is the last day to register. So go ahead, if you're interested, find someone and they can help you register. Or you can scan the QR code and register through there. It's always a fun time. Retreat is always a really good time, so don't miss out. We have today a children's ministry training. So all current and prospective children's ministry volunteers, please plan on attending. If you've ever considered volunteering in children's ministry, it is a wonderful place to kind of get your feet wet into ministry. You always have support, too. There's always kind of one or two people in there with you to help out. So if you're nervous, go ahead and head to the meeting. Learn a little bit more about children's ministry. We are always in need of children ministry volunteers. So please give a little plug for Shauna and Carlos. And go ahead and attend that meeting so you can learn a little bit more about it. If you are currently a children's ministry volunteer, please go so you can get some more information there. So our second half of our spring small group study is going to start. It's a six-week study by John Piper. It's called Seeing and Savoring Jesus, and it is starting this week. So if you are interested, if you want to get connected to a group, go ahead and find Alan Holman. There he is. So he can connect you to a group. He'll let you know where, when, who, how, all the details. Go ahead and check in with him. Softball. If you enjoy softball, watching or playing, please join our team. It's a co-ed softball. Anyone 14 and older is welcome to come. The first game was Friday. Oh, and we won. Very exciting. Woo! Good job. Games are played at Bethany Bible Church on Shepherd and Maple on Friday evening. So go ahead and get a hold of Pete or Letty Perez if you are interested in playing. Or if you just want to come out and cheer, that's great too. Finally, if you are not added to our email list, please do so. You can email church@harvestfresno.org, and we will get you added to our, so you can get our weekly emails. You can receive all these updates that I'm telling you. You can receive them through that email link. So I think that's it. I'll pass it off. Have a great Sunday.
Good morning, church. Can we stand together? Okay, now, raise your hand if you are one of my clappers. Okay, there we go. I'm identifying you now because when the song starts, you actually have to clap. And those of you that don't know how to clap, follow these clappers, and we're going to do the best that we can to sing at the same time. Here we go. Here's your clapping. There you go. Perfect. That sounds wonderful. We waited for this day. We waited for this day. We're gathered in your name. We're calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. So open up, so open up the heavens. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Your presence in this place, Lord. Your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now, Lord, unveil us. So open up the heavens. We want to see you open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
So open up the heavens, Lord.
So open up the heavens. We want to see you open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
Just the ladies. Show us your glory.
Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
Everyone together, show us your glory, Lord.
Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
Last week in our text, Pastor Ben referred to the Lord, his presence going before Moses, the presence of Jesus going before the disciples. God, we pray your presence.
So open up the heavens. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
We pray, open up the heavens, Lord.
So open up the heavens. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
Amen. Lord, that you would show your presence, that you would meet with us in this place and reveal yourself to us so that we might come to know you more, so that we might enter into this space and be changed by your Holy Spirit, because you are a good, good God. We love you. Amen.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In the darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am in, goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me.
Singing, your goodness is running.
Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
You came down.
Son of God, you
there be no higher name, Jesus, Son of God. You laid down your perfect life. You are the sacrifice, Jesus, Son of God. You are Jesus, Son of God. On the altar of our praise, let there be no higher name, Jesus, Son of God. You laid down your perfect life. You are the sacrifice, Jesus, Son of God. You are Jesus, Son of God. Jesus, Son of God. Thank you so much for worshiping with us. You may be seated.
Good morning, church. Wonderful to be here with all of you and worship the Lord together. For those, again, watching online, we want to welcome you as we worship the Lord together. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for this opportunity to gather together to worship you. And again, we realize that this is a great gift. It's a privilege, something that we never would have done, left to our own devices. But you, again, the hound from heaven came down and rescued us, delivered us. And so based on that, Lord, we are here to worship you as, through your Son. And it's our desire to highly exalt him. So I pray, Lord, that it would be your words that go forth this morning, knowing that your words are unique. Your words are different than any other words. They are living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. So I pray that it would be your words that do a mighty work in our hearts, to do what we can never do on our own, and that's to be changed internally, that we would have our hearts transformed and conformed into the image of beloved Son, again, for our good and for your glory. In Jesus' name I pray this, amen. It is difficult to overestimate the importance of bread around the world. In most countries, it's an absolute essential food group to have. Now, here in the West, there's a little bit of a stigma attached to bread because we talk about, being on a low-carb diet and all sorts of things like that. But around the world, it is a necessity. It is absolutely essential to have bread. In fact, when there is a shortage of bread, then you see even riots. In places in the Middle East, for example, especially in the Middle East, bread is just a necessity. And you see, for example, in Syria, what people are willing to do, that's to get their daily ration of bread, willing to stand in line. And when there's a disruption, like when the Russia invaded the Ukraine, and that Ukraine is one of the largest wheat suppliers in the world and one of the greatest exporters of wheat to the Middle East. And it created a huge disruption in their supply chain of getting wheat for bread. You actually had riots. And you had humanitarian organizations being the ones to deliver bread because it is that essential and that important, that vital as part of their livelihood and life-sustaining to have life-sustaining food. people clamor for it. And the portion of scripture that we've landed on today, Jesus claims to be the bread of life. The bread of life. Now, we know that if you eat regular bread, you eat physical bread, you eat it, right? Then what happens? Over time, you get hungry again. And you need to eat it again. But Jesus said, he's the bread of life, and whoever eats of him will never hunger again. So this is what we're going to be looking at today. We actually are picking up from the sermon of Jesus feeding the 5,000 men, which is equivalent to 15,000 to 20,000 men, women, and children. And remember that that was a portion of scripture where we talked about how to never hunger again. Well, this is part two of that. And this is really an explanation of Jesus feeding the multitude of people. So, and that's where we're going to pick up in John chapter 6, verse 22 to 40. And as I mentioned, Jesus had just fed the multitude, 15 to 20,000 people. They ate as much as they wanted. They were full, and there were 12 baskets left over. That's how much food was produced. Naturally, they thought that Jesus was the Messiah. The Messiah that they were hoping to have. The one that was going to deliver them. The one that was going to feed them. The one who was going to heal their illness. The one who was going to be the political power to deliver them from Roman occupation. And because he performed this miracle, the people wanted to empower him. And we read in John chapter 6, verse 14 and 15, when the people saw the sign that he had done, meaning the feeding, they said, "This indeed is a prophet who has come into the world." Perceiving then that they were about to come and take him by force and make him king, Jesus withdrew again to the mountain by himself. So, sandwiched between the feeding of the 5,000 and Jesus' explanation of it was the event of Jesus sending out his disciples in the Sea of Galilee, creating a storm, then walking on the storm, and showing his disciples who he truly is. And once they realized that, what happened? They worshiped him for who he truly was. So we see that event, and that was to show the disciples who he was. Because there was a false belief even of the disciples, thinking, yes, we're ready to go. Again, they had been empowered to preach with a miraculous power when they went two by two and preached the gospel. And so they were empowered. Jesus just fed 20,000 people, and they thought, okay, the messianic expectation was at a fever pitch here, and they were ready to go. Let's go march on the Capitol and take over. So he had to set them straight. And that's what he did with his disciples on the Sea of Galilee in the storm. And now he's going to do that with the multitudes here. So, how to never hunger again, part two. First, you need the right appetite. You need the right appetite. Verse 22, on the next day, the crowd remained on the other side of the sea, on the other side of the sea, and saw that there had been only one boat there, and that Jesus had not entered the boat with his disciples, but that his disciples had gone away alone. Other boats from Tiberias came to the place where they had eaten bread after the Lord had given thanks. So when the crowd saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they themselves got into boats and went to Capernaum seeking Jesus. And when they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" And Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me not because you saw signs, but because you ate and you're full of loaves." So it's, again, easy to understand the excitement and the eagerness of the people to see Jesus again. He had just been engaged. It's now 2 years into his public ministry. He performed many, many miracles. People were very well aware of that. Again, the disciples had performed miracles. The people were aware of that. And Jesus just fed 15 to 20,000 people miraculously. They were very well of that. They witnessed all of these miracles. And so Jesus, at this point in time, goes to the mountain by himself. It says in the text that the crowd knew that the disciples were sent off in a boat by themselves without Jesus. So this is the next day. And if Jesus were to go to Capernaum, he was going to have to go pass by them. And he didn't. So they wake up looking for Jesus. It's breakfast after all, right? We had dinner. We're ready for breakfast. Where's our meal ticket? And he's nowhere to be found. So they go looking for him. And you see here a map. And you see that it says that boats came from, is that the map of the Sea of Galilee? There we go. Okay, so you see the feeding, and you see Capernaum over there. Well, it turns out that boats came from the Tiberias area. Probably the commentators think that they're either people who became aware that Jesus fed all those people and they wanted to get in on the action, or that these were businessmen. These were, in a sense, like boat taxis, and they were coming because they knew that's kind of in the middle of nowhere, that these people are going to have to go somewhere, so they were going to give them rides. So these boats came, and they ultimately got into the boat and went to Capernaum, and they traveled across the sea. And when they found him there on the other side, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" So when the people got to the other side, they went there because they know that was Jesus' hometown, and eventually they would hopefully see him. But when they got there, he was already there. They had no idea how he got there. In other words, when they're saying, "When did you come here?" they're really saying, "How in the world did you get here? We didn't see you." And Jesus didn't answer that question, knowing that if he would have answered that question and told them how he actually got there, it would have just fanned the fuel of their messianic expectation and fever, but again, having the wrong expectation of who the Messiah truly is. So instead, Jesus responds by saying, and Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves." So Jesus gets to the heart of the issue, laying bare their superficial requirements and desire to have food and miracles. Jesus knew it was breakfast time and they wanted another free meal. That's basically why they were coming to him. But after the Jews had been, and again, that's a reasonable expectation that the Jews had. Why? Because they had been taught that when the next Messiah comes, he is going to, in a sense, replicate the miracles of Moses of feeding the people with manna. And it's in their commentaries. It says, "You shall not find manna in this age, but you shall find it in the age coming." Speaking of the Messianic age. And if he was truly the Messiah, so that's what the expectation of, if someone's the Messiah, he's going to reproduce the miracles of feeding everyone with manna from heaven. So if Jesus was truly Messiah, they had every reason to expect that they were going to get another meal. Again, especially since manna was provided 6 days, right, out of the week, every single day. But even with that belief, they were seeking Jesus for the wrong reason, the wrong motive, the wrong appetite, if you will. They wanted him to provide material and physical benefits. They wanted Jesus to meet their needs, not provide them with their greatest need of eternal life, because they were sinners, and then worship him accordingly. So let me ask you, Why do you seek after Jesus? If you were to answer that question honestly, I think it will reveal a number of different motives that are really in our hearts. Basically, we come to Jesus, we go to Jesus when what we treasure is threatened. When we think that we may not get it, get what we want. Materially, in the physical realm, whether possessions are in jeopardy, threatened, finances, relationships, our control over our circumstances is not what we want it to be, so we go to Jesus. But we should never forget, Jesus is omniscient. He knows all things. He knows why you are coming to him. He knows why you are petitioning him. He's all-knowing. He knows the motives of your heart. He knows exactly why you come to him. He knows why you go to church. He knows why you got baptized. He knows why you take the Lord's Supper. He knows why you do devotions. Now, for me, you can fool me, right? If you have a credible, at least a verbal, profession of faith, and that's matched by basic attendance in church, participation in church events, going to a small group, yeah, it could be quite a while before, if ever, I ever learn whether or not you're truly saved. But that's not the case with Jesus. Our hearts are naked and exposed before his gaze. As 1 Samuel 16:7, he says, "For the Lord sees not as man sees. The man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." And I think, again, if we're honest, we all have to say that we have come to the Lord with wrong motives, wrong appetites. The thing is, when the Holy Spirit convicts us of that through the Word, the good news is that we could respond with repentance. And he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And he does it because he loves you. So we can have potentially wrong motives, and we have a remedy. But I also want you to not make the mistake on the other end of the spectrum, and that is to say, you know what, I'm not going to help move chairs because, you know what, my heart's not right over that. Yeah, you know. I'd just be doing it to just show the people that I'm actually, you know, willing to work for the Lord when I really don't want to. It's kind of late, and I want to get to lunch, and I'd only do it just so I could get to lunch. I don't really care about moving the chairs for the Lord, right? At that case, it doesn't matter what your motive is. It's always right to do what is right. And let your motives then follow if you have wrong motives. So it's always right to do what's right. And again, that's regardless of your motive. So we are looking at how to never hunger again. First is that you need the right appetite. Secondly, you need the right work. You need the right work. Verse 27, "Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For on him God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to be doing the works of God?" And Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him who he has sent." So Jesus gives a strong rebuke here. He says, don't work for the food that perishes, which they sought, but basically work for the food that endures, brings eternal life. Now, he's not making a blanket condemnation of working for food. Everyone needs to work for food. In fact, it's condemned if you don't work for food in 2 Thessalonians 3:10. He says, if you don't work, you don't eat. But Jesus is, again, not unmindful of everyone's physical needs. But he's here interested in your spiritual need, the spiritual needs of people, which is much greater than a physical need. Eventually, we're all going to die. And eternity is a long time. So the more important question is, where are you going to spend eternity? Not where you're going to get your next meal. But how many of us do the same thing that Jesus is warning here, the crowd, against? Laboring for food that perishes. And neglecting the feeding of our own souls. How often do we do that? Jesus is exhorting the crowd to work for food that brings eternal life. And here it says that this food that brings eternal life, God has set his seal on it. It's God the Father has set his seal, meaning his approval. He's authenticating Jesus is the source of that food. He's authenticating and legitimizing Jesus' claim to be that food. It's a seal of approval. Now, the thing about what Jesus just said is that this work for food that never perishes but gives life, there's two words in Greek for life. One is bios and one is zoe. Bios is physical life, and zoe is a quality of life that's more often used for eternal life. And that's the term for life that he's using. So now that's getting the crowd stirring a little bit, trying to figure out, what is he really saying? We were talking about bread for physical life, for bios life, and now he's talking about zoe, this eternal life. What is going on here? They're getting a little bit of an idea that what Jesus is saying, what they think he's saying, he really isn't saying, that there's more going on. So what is he saying? Well, Jesus is offering the only food that could quench the ache of a hungry soul. Christ is ready to provide whatever mercy, whatever grace is needed for your soul to be satisfied, that he will freely give immediately. So, the crowd, we're finally getting it. We understand that you're not just talking about the physical. Okay, you want us to work for eternal life. We get that. We understand that. Now I know what you mean. You want us to work in a certain way so that we can have that eternal life. The Jewish people understand completely what that means. Their whole religion is based on works to get eternal life. And Jesus is just reaffirming what they already believe, that they need to work for eternal life. And now he's going to show them what work is really going to be satisfying, what work is really going to be pleasing to the Lord. And again, this is an error that basically every single religion except true biblical Christianity embraces, that you're working somehow your way to get approval and to get into heaven, some way, somehow, to get to a higher plane. It's always based on works. Now, even Christians will say, professing Christians will say, well, salvation is by faith and some works. They may believe in the facts that Jesus died for your sins, but you also have to do a bunch of other things. And this really is a way to preserve man's, in a sense, pride, that he did something for his salvation, that he could participate in glory. And it's a way, in a sense, we don't really think of it this way, but they kind of like the fact that I'm doing this for the Lord, and now he's indebted to me to grant favor and eternal life. But Paul writes in Romans chapter 3, verse 20, By the works of the law, no human will be justified in his sight, and since through the law comes knowledge of sin. So the law, people obey, thinking that they're going to get God's favor, really only condemns them. It's there to act as a tutor to point people of their sin and great need of a Savior, and ultimately point to Christ. So, this is not the way of salvation. So, what is the way? Verse 29, Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him who he has sent." So salvation doesn't come from human effort, human achievement, human work. It comes from faith. There's no amount of good we could do to find favor before God. His demand, well, there is, it's perfection. Be holy, as be perfect as our Heavenly Father is perfect. That's a requirement for God's to get God's favor. Or not, right? So salvation is by faith, by grace alone, in Christ alone, through faith alone. That's what we believe, right? That's what Christians believe. Ephesians 2:8, "For by grace you've been saved through faith, and that's not of your own doing. It's a gift of God." The very faith is a gift. And all that's required is for us to believe. Acts 16:31, "Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved." So then what is the work of believing? What is the work that he's talking about that is associated with believing? The work is that we give up trying to do things to gain God's favor. That's the work. To try to please him by our own efforts. That's the work that we need to do to be saved. The Lord is referring to us simply believing. And the benefit isn't the belief itself. There's nothing truly valuable in belief. It's in the object of our belief. So our work and the work is not our faith. Oh, I have to build up this faith and then I'll be saved. No. Our work is our faith is always flawed. It's always defective. It's not our faith that saves us. It's again the object of our faith that saves us. So we have to trust in Christ's work, not our own. The work is believing that Christ has done it all. That the earnings, in a sense, it's trusting in Christ's perfect work record, not ours. The earnings that Christ earned that pays your sin debt, that's what we have to believe. Your sin debt is credited to him, and forgiveness is credited to you, and his righteousness is credited to you. And you believe this by faith. That's the work that God requires of you. That you cast aside your own self-righteousness as a way to gain favor with God. That you cast aside your pride. Cast aside the things that you think you can do to earn his favor. And instead you confess your guilt and need for a Savior. and simply trust in your son, in this son. No. The problem is that many professing believers say they believe in salvation by faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. They believe it. They say they believe it. But they don't. It's not that they don't. It's that they don't live by it. There's a difference. We all fail to truly live out our lives like we believe that salvation is by faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. How do you know? Well, let me ask you a question. Do you ever beat yourself up over sin? Your past sin. The records of your past. Does a record of your past, does a tape of your past just go through your head and discourage you? Take the energy out of you. Cause you to be depressed. And then do you then wake up and say, I'm going to do better? Yeah, I messed up. I really blew it. I sinned. But you know what? I'm going to do my small group homework. I'm going to be prepared. I'm going to make sure I go to church and hear God's word. I'm going to wake up and do the devotion that I always think I'm going to do. But you know what? I'm really going to do it. You see, you're working for food that perishes in that case. And that's how you know whether or not you really believe that you're saved by faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. In a sense, you're working the wrong job. You haven't cast down your self-righteousness or pride, because you are thinking and you're condemning yourself, but thinking that you are better than who you are, that you have more righteousness than you really possess. And it's really the sin of pride that causes us to think that we're thinking better of ourselves, that how dare I, of all people, commit that sin? I of all people, should not be doing that sin. I can't believe I did that. And that is, again, pride. We have not done the work of belief or cast out our pride or self-righteousness, because we don't have any righteousness of our own. Our righteousness is foreign. It's sitting at the right hand of God the Father. It exists in Christ, not ourselves. So to never hunger again, we need to do the right work. So we're looking at how to never hunger again. First, we need the right appetite. Secondly, we need the right work. Thirdly, we need the right food. We need the right food. Verse 30, so they said to him, then what sign do you do that we may see and believe you? What work do you perform? Our fathers ate manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. So Jesus is saying that they need to work for food that never perishes, and they're saying, okay, there's more going on here, and you're saying that you're part of this. You know what? You not providing brunch this morning is really not working for me. You know? The guy on the boat, the taxi driver on the boat, was offering food, and I'm thinking, you know, why pay this high price for food when as soon as I see Jesus, he's going to give me all the food I could eat? So I'm kind of hungry and cranky, and now you're saying you're the Messiah. Show us some signs so that I really know that you're the Messiah. Come on, do some work. Moses, you know, Moses was real. He was the real deal, and he gave his people food. So come on, let's go. Bring it on. Give us a sign. You're really the Messiah. Again, Moses provided food. The hardness of an unbeliever's heart can never be overestimated. In fact, in the Bible, it never says that really Jesus was surprised, except in one place I'm aware of. There might be more, you can point it out. But in Mark 6:6, it says, he marveled at their unbelief. I've done all these things for you. Are you kidding me? You are still doubting who I am after all you've seen? Seriously? Well, they ask for a sign. And it really doesn't matter what sign they would have seen, they would not have believed. In Luke 16:31, he says, those who reject the truth of God's word will never be persuaded, even if someone raises up from the dead. At the time of Jesus' crucifixion, the Jewish leaders mocked him, said, let this Christ, the King of Israel, now come down off the cross so that we may see and believe. So perform a miracle. Come down. Show us a sign. And yet when Jesus rose from the dead, they wouldn't even accept that. They made up all these excuses, lies, say that you were sleeping, and or someone stole the body. They refused to believe the facts in front of them. One commentator noted that we should do well by remembering this when sharing our faith. We shouldn't get discouraged when people don't believe, that our efforts are futile. We shouldn't complain when people aren't responding the way that we want them to respond. They did this with Jesus, who performed all these miracles, all these signs. What do you think they're going to do when you try to share the gospel? You have any expectation that it's going to be really different apart from the work of God, which we're going to talk about in 2 weeks in detail? No, we shouldn't be surprised. We shouldn't get discouraged. We're seed planters. We're not in charge of people's salvation. God is. So then Jesus responds to them when they demand for another sign. Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. So Jesus had no intention of fanning the flame of performing another miracle because, again, their misplaced messianic expectations. He didn't really want to reinforce any notion that would encourage them to want him to be the political Messiah that they were hoping for. So he explains kind of a difference between the manna that the people in the wilderness received and the food, the bread of life that he has to offer. One commentator noted the difference. First, he tells them here in this passage that it's not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven. It was God. Moses was the delivery man here. And he just gave instructions. And secondly, manna was not the true bread from heaven. Jesus said, my Father now gives you the true bread. So that bread from heaven, the manna, was just food to sustain you physically. What the Father is giving you through Christ is true bread that will sustain you forever. And it says what he gives you, he's using a present tense that the bread that the Father gives you, is what he's currently giving you, is distinguished from what he gave in the past, showing that there's a distinction here. Thirdly, the manna gave just physical life. But the bread that God is bringing with the bread of heaven gives you eternal life. And finally, manna was just given to the people of Israel. Here he's saying the true bread from heaven is for the world, for everyone to consume. And Jesus is that bread. And they said to him, okay, at this point, they're saying, you have bread? This type of bread? Give us this, sir, give us this bread always. And that, actually, the always is emphatic. Oh, sir, always, always give us this bread. Their response, again, was they wanted Jesus to provide wonder bread. They wanted Jesus to provide this bread that was going to have this supernatural impact in their life to enable them to do things and have, you know, supernatural power. They failed to understand that he was really still talking only on the spiritual level. They were once again reducing Jesus to this cosmic genie who was there to supply their needs. And in this case, their desires, whatever they want, to have this abundant life. And this is what is taught in churches around the world. It's called the prosperity gospel. Come to Jesus, and he'll empower you to get what you want in life. To be the best you. That means a promotion. That means a better this, a better that, a bigger house, whatever you want. Jesus is your ticket. Still being taught today. They meant to see Jesus as a means to an end. In reality, Jesus is the end. He's not a means to an end. He is the end. We were created for him. So in case there was any misunderstanding about this bread, Jesus makes it very clear, verse 35, Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger. Whoever believes in me shall never thirst eternal life. I will raise him up on the last day. So again, any misconception they have about who is this bread having this eternal life, Jesus saying, I am it. He actually says, I am the bread of life. Once again, the ego me statement, the I am, calling Jesus himself the personal name of God, Yahweh. Just like he did to the disciples in the boat when he appeared before him, he said, I am. Do not be frightened. In other words, Yahweh, I'm your personal God. The same name that was used with Moses at the burning bush when he said, who shall I say sent me? Tell him I am. He's using the same words here. And again, this is the start of these repetition of these I am statements where Jesus says, I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the gate. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection of the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And then he uses separately, just independently, like we looked at last week. He's declaring himself to be God. He's declaring himself to be not just a delivery man, but the source of life itself. The one who can give eternal life, not just physical life. But notice, Jesus didn't say, I'm the escargot of life. He didn't say that. Jesus didn't say, I'm the fettuccine Alfredo of life. Come to me and you'll never hunger. And keeping with the Lamb of God metaphor, right? Jesus didn't say, I'm the lamb chop of life. Come to me and you'll never hunger. He said he's the bread of life. Again, going back to the significance of bread. Bread was, in that time, necessary for life. Again, it was the staple of life. When Jesus was teaching his disciples to pray, in the very beginning he said, give us this day our daily bread. It represents sustenance for being able to live. to survive. Just as we need food for our bodies to live, he's offering food for our souls to have eternal life. And this bread is universal. Go to almost any country in the world and they're going to have a form of bread, which is a staple in their diet. It's bread is consumed by the poor and the wealthy alike. There's no distinction. All eat it, all need it, and again, it's part of our daily. It wouldn't be surprising to see bread in the morning or bread at lunch and bread at dinner. So it is with Christ. There's no day that we don't need him. He is our daily bread. He is the bread of life. It says, whoever comes to me shall not hunger, but whoever believes in me shall never have eternal life. Will have eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. So come and believe. What does that mean? It's pretty much a synonym for repent and believe. And faith. Repentance and faith are two sides of a coin. They're inseparable. To come to Jesus is to forsake what you had before, what you were loving before, what you were clinging to before for salvation, and coming to him. Turning from those things and coming to him, believing in him, believing that he truly is your Savior, believing that he truly did die for your sins, believe that he really did live a perfect sinless life that you never could live, really believing that he rose on the third day and ascended to heaven. You do that, your soul will never hunger again. Unlike the restless souls of people always trying to find satisfaction in this world, trying to find other things to bring that craving that the soul hungers for, and again, possession and position and your children and relationships, and you're going to hunger again. In Greek mythology, there was King Tantalus, and he was punished in the underworld, chained to a lake with his waters that reached the chin, his chin. So he was put in a lake up to his chin. And when he had thirst, when he bent down to drink the water, it would recede. So he never would be able to drink the water. And above him was just an abundance, cornucopia, of fruit. And the problem was that whenever he tried to reach up for it, it receded. It went away. And that's how it is with man's attempt to satisfy his soul. He can never do it. It's never satisfying. But the Lord says, you come to him, you shall never hunger, you shall never thirst. Now, it doesn't mean that you'll never experience want in your life, you'll never experience any deficiency, or never have periods of discouragement or dry seasons in your life. Even lose your sense of being forgiven. Lose your joy and enjoyment in the Lord. Yes, all those things are possible. But once you put your faith in Christ, your soul will never perish. It will have eternal life. Yes, there are some things that can influence us in our thinking and in how we're perceiving things in this life, but the objective truth is that your soul will never perish. It will never truly hunger and never thirst because of Christ. Because of what he's done, he's become your life. And Jesus offers this freely. So next time we meet, we are going to talk about who can come. And it's a controversial subject. And when we have those type of subjects, I tend to use a lot of scripture because I want to show that it's not my opinion, it's the Word of God. So the next time that we meet together, you be ready to go through a lot of different scriptures, and we're going to deal with some very hard teaching, some controversial teaching about sovereign election and who could come to the Lord and who isn't coming to the Lord and all of those different things. So that's going to be the next time that we meet. So again, we just looked at how to never hunger again. You need the right appetite, you need the right work, and you need the right food. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful that you have given us everything we need to have eternal life, that you give it freely, without discrimination, to anyone who would come to you. You freely give. And we are so grateful that you have revealed yourself to us in a way that we have been able to partake in the bread of life. Again, knowing that it was because you first loved us and because of your irresistible grace that we have done this. So we are so grateful for that. And I just pray that if there's someone who has not received you as the bread of life, that today would be the day of their salvation. Today would be the day where they have the bread of life. Today would be the day where the longing of their soul is satisfied because they've come to you. They've surrendered their life to you. They've cast aside their pride, their self-righteousness, and thinking that there's another way to be right with you. And they have forsaken all of that and surrendered and trusted in the only Savior for sinners, Jesus Christ. In his precious name we pray this. Amen.
Can we stand together as we close? Lord, I come. Lord, I come. I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall. You're my hope and stay. Teach my song, to teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
It was wonderful worshiping with all of you this morning. And again, if there's someone who has not put their faith and trust in Jesus, we'd love to talk to you, show you through the gospel of Jesus Christ how you can have eternal life, how you could satisfy the hunger of your soul. So just reach out to me, a deacon, an elder, and we'd be happy to share the good news with you. Author of Hebrews writes, "Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of his eternal covenant, equip you with every good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever." And all of God's people said, amen. Thank you. You are loved.